Okay, welcome everyone to the Data Science and Computational Statistics Seminar organized jointly by the School of Mathematics and the School of Computer Science at the University of Birmingham. And today it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Daniel Sanz-Alonso from University of Chicago. And Daniel completed his PhD in Mathematics and Statistics at the University of Warwick in 2016. And he then moved on to the United States at the Brown University as a postdoctoral research associate and also member of the Data Science Initiative at Brown. So then he moved on to the University of Chicago in the Department of Statistics in 2018 as an assistant professor since then. So Daniel has a wider range of research interest in data science and computational statistics, including data assimilation, inverse problem, graph-based learning, and uncertainty quantifications. So today, he will tell us about graphical approximations of Gaussian fields, theory, and applications. Thank you, Daniel.
Thank you very much, Xiaoxian, for the invitation and for the introduction. So the work that I'm going to present today, all of it is together with a PhD student at the University of Chicago called Ruiyi Yang. And what I'm going to cover today is ways to approximate Gaussian fields using graph-based constructions. And I'm going to discuss some of the theory behind it and a few applications. But before going into the theory and applications, I'm going to introduce some of the motivation as to why one may be interested in approximating Gaussian fields with graphs. So, the starting point is to remember the definition of a Gaussian field as a function that is random in some domain of interest. And usually Gaussian fields are described through the covariance function that prescribes what is the covariance of your random function at locations x and x tilde. And there's many ways to construct this covariance function, and that is the main modeling choice while working with Gaussian fields or Gaussian processes. A particular model that I will be focusing on is the Matern model, which specifies the covariance of the random field at points x and x tilde in terms of this complicated function. There's many reasons why this model has become the model of choice in many applications. One of them is that it is described by three parameters that have a very clear interpretation and that can be learned from data. Those parameters in this notation are the marginal variance sigma squared, which tells you what is the variance of your random function at a given point in your domain. The length scale, which models the decay of correlations between points and x tilde as they are further apart. And the smoothness of the field, which tells you what is the almost sure regularity that you have for your random function. In this case, models of the parameter nu, so that if nu is larger, the random function is guaranteed to have higher smoothness. So the popularity of the Matern model is very wide in terms of the number of applications where it is used, and it is partly also due to the fact that this kind of similar work by Michael Style is summarized in section 1.6 by giving the practical advice of using this Matern model over competitive models. So one caveat of working with Gaussian fields and with, for example, with this convergence model is that if you want to sample your random function at L points, then you need to construct the convergence matrix with the L points that you have, and you need to factorize it. And the cost of doing that scales like the cube of the number of points that you have. So that if you want to sample the field at L points, or if you want to infer the parameters at given L observations of the field, the cost is typically cubic. So another way to think about this model, which is the one that I'm going to advocate and follow in this talk, is through the SPD approach, which was popularized by the paper by Lilgrand and co-authors, although it dates much farther back to the 50s. And the idea here is that rather than thinking in terms of the covariance function, one defines the Gaussian field W, which again is a random function, as the solution of a stochastic partial differential equation. Here, the resulting definition of W depends also on two parameters, in this case, tau and s. And it can be made to depend on a third parameter just by multiplying this whole equation but by another constant. And by doing that, there's a correspondence between the parameters of the Matern model and the parameters that one gets from this SPD definition. So that in this definition of the Matern model, the length scale is modeled through tau, and the smoothness of the field is modeled through S. And one can also incorporate, as I said, a third parameter here by pre-multiplying the equation by a constant, which would model the marginal variance of the field. The main motivation to use this kind of alternative way to define the same covariance model that was advocated in the paper by Lilgrand and co-authors is that one can then discretize this SPDE using finite elements. And by doing that, one can represent the field as a Gauss-Markov random field, which has a sparse precision matrix. And so because of the sparsity of the precision matrix, the computational cost can be reduced. So that, as I said, the cost here scales with the cubic of the number of points where you want to sample or the number of observations that you have. Here, the cost would be reduced depending on the sparsity of the precision matrix substantially. So by then, the upshot of this is by following this SPD approach and solving the SPD with finite elements representing that way the field, one can approximate this model, which is the model of choice in many applications. And one can do that at a reduced computational cost by exploiting that factorizing a sparse matrix is often cheaper. This idea that working with Gaussian fields with a sparse precision matrix gets you computational advantage is very well described in this other book, Gauss, Markov, Random Fields, by Ruiyi and Yang that I have here. So this is the book I suggested for matrix models, and this is the book I suggest for the study of Gauss, Markov, Random Fields. So the main idea.
I have a question here.
Yeah, sure.
Can you go back to the SPDE approach?
Yes.
Is this equation a linear equation, right?
Linear
system, right? Can you invert it directly?
Yeah. So the the way that we are actually thinking about this definition, and this is an important question, is. That throughout this talk, we are going to set this SPD as being defined in a compact manifold, in which case this operator has a discrete spectrum. And so we can then formalize the solution of this SPD, and by doing that, the definition of the Gaussian field W. In terms of a Kerhoff-Loewe expansion with the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions of this operator, which has a discrete spectrum. But that is a delicate and important point, because one of another advantage that I didn't emphasize here of thinking about the Matern model in terms of this SPD rather than the covariance function itself is that this SPD, you can define it in many domains or manifolds, and still it can be well defined even by complementing it with different type of boundary conditions. However, if you think about this as defining Gaussian field, somehow, this definition is already implicitly assuming that you are in a Euclidean setting. And this norm here between x and x tilde is the Euclidean norm, right? And so that's a good point. One way in which we will, the way that we will think about W throughout the talk is as a Gaussian measure that has zero mean, and the covariance operator would be just defined by the tau identity minus Laplacian to the power minus s. Okay.
Okay. So if it's defined on graph, then it's graph Laplacian, right? This.
Yes. So that's actually what we are going to be doing.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
So the main idea and the main thing that we are going to do in this talk is to analyze and study what we get by basically replacing, as you were saying here, this Laplace operator, which I left unspecified, by a graph Laplacian. And so by doing that, we are going to define a Gauss Markov random field with precision matrix defined in terms of a graph Laplacian, which I will define in 1 second. And some of the benefits of doing this and some of the things that I will show are that, first of all, if this equation is set on a manifold, and by doing that, we would be defining a Matern field on a manifold setting. Then, as we construct this graph more using more and more points, some point from the manifold, this Gauss Markov random field that I'm going to define using a graph Laplacian converges to the Matern model. Okay, so we can obtain theoretical guarantees of convergence of the graph field to the Matern model on a manifold. But in addition to doing that, because of the sparsity of the graph Laplacian, WL, so the graph representation of the Matern field also has sparse precision metrics. And thereby, as I mentioned, one gets a computational advantage over using directly the Matern model. And the third thing is that the construction that I'm going to show for WL generalizes to arbitrary point clouds. So that as long as we have a bunch of points and a similarity notion between them, this object is well-defined, can be suitably defined, okay? So if the points used to construct the graph are samples from a manifold, we approximate the Matern model. If they are not and they are abstract points and the graph Laplacian is defined in terms of abstract similarity, this object is still well-defined. So then I'm going to describe a bit how we construct this graph Laplacian and how we are going to define this field WL. So this will be familiar for some, but just to be on the same page, graph Laplacian is a matrix, which in order to define it, the only thing that you need is to have access to a matrix that I call H that has non-negative entries. So a good way to think about this for intuition, for quick intuition, is that a graph Laplacian is a way to turn a matrix that has non-negative entries into a matrix here that is positive semi-definite. The way that we interpret this matrix H is that Hij represents the similarity between two points, Xi and Xj. And the reason why turning a non-negative matrix into a positive semi-definite matrix is useful in this and other settings is because then it can be used as a regularizer in learning problems or to define prior distributions in Bayesian formulations. So the way to see that is that if we think of V as a vector at these points Xi and Xj, then we have capital L points and this quantity here, you can think of it as representing the norm of the gradient squared. And you see that it is indeed non-negative, showing that, as I claimed, this matrix is positive semi-definite. And what you can see is that this norm is going to be small, provided that V takes similar values at points Xi and Xj, whenever Xi is close to Xj. Okay, so in order for this to be small, this kind of is imposing the condition that V has to vary smoothly across the points Xi. And it has to vary smoothly respecting the fact that V has to take similar values at points that are close together, close being specified through the similarity matrix.
So is this natural regularizer something similar to spectral clustering, right? If we
use the identity. So these graph are, yeah, they are very widely used in spectral clustering and many unsupervised learning applications, yes. And there's actually, I mean, this I'm kind of giving for context. There's many other ways to define graph Laplacians. This is just one of them, which is called the unnormalized graph Laplacian. There's many others, symmetric, random walk. And for people who may want to read more about that, I recommend a review paper on a tutorial on spectral clustering by Ulrike von Luxburg.
So, sorry, one more question. Is V here a binary function or indicator function?
Well, V here can be anything. It can be, so you can think of V as a vector in RL and each of its coordinates representing the value of a function there. But in principle, it can be anything.
Okay, thank you.
And actually, in most cases, one would think of V, its coordinates taking arbitrary values, not necessarily 0 and 1. Okay. So then, something I want to emphasize is that this construction is very, very general in terms that I didn't make any assumption as to where what these points xi and xj represent. In order to construct this matrix and this regularizer, the only thing that you need is to have access to this similarity matrix. Now, if the xi's are actually points that are sampled from an m-dimensional manifold, then we can, for reasons that will become apparent later on, define the similarity between points xi and xj in terms of this specific definition. So in short, we are going to say that this L3 takes this value if the points xi and xj are closer than some distance apart and zero otherwise. This distance here.
So, sorry, can I just that before you, can you, in the sum above, sum also with way to z, right? So z is a number, gives you a number.
Oh, yes. In the sum. There's a typo here, I think. Yeah, this ILJ, yeah.
Okay, so it okay, so this kind of a norm, yeah, okay. Hmm.
You're right. Yeah, so what I was saying is that this norm here can be either the Euclidean or the Riemannian metric on the distance on the manifold. Okay, so then just to for the definition of this object WL that I started with. The way it's going to be defined is in this precise way. So these xi's and lambdas are the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of this graph Laplacian matrix. So this is, as I claimed, a form of a truncated SVD, so that it is a diagonalization of this matrix, but I incorporate here a truncating parameter so that I will not keep all the frequencies, but just the first few. The parameters tau and s are exactly playing the same role as in this SPD. In order to define this Gauss-Markov random field, there's this additional parameter that describes the connectivity of the graph, and this truncation parameter that discards eigenvalues and eigenfunctions that do not approximate well the underlying Laplacian operator. I didn't add again the marginal variance parameter because that can be easily dealt with by multiplying by a constant. And what I want to emphasize is that this WL, if the truncation parameter was not there, so like if I kept all the frequencies, has this particular form where it is just replacing the Laplace-Beltrami operator on the manifold with graph Laplacian. In addition to that, this SPD formulation, and this is something that was observed also by in the paper by Lindgren, opens the possibility of generalizing the Matern model by incorporating non-stationarity. So by precisely what one means by that is that this tau and this operator this Laplace operator that we had in the SPD can be replaced by specially varying functions. And by doing that, one obtains non-stationary fields such that they are not isotropic. Okay, so in the same way, as we constructed this graph representation of the Matern model, we can also deal with non-stationary Matern models by using an analogous construction using graph-based objects. So a first result that formalizes the convergence of this graph Matern models is that, and this is an informal statement, the graph based Matern field approximates W, where W is the Matern field on the underlying manifold. And we have bounds in both L2 and L infinity. And we have rates that depend on the regularity of the, on the smoothness of the underlying field, so on S. But all of them take this kind of particular form where the error scales as something that depends on the smoothness of the field and inversely on the dimension of the underlying manifold. And the way that this approximation is formalized is that while this is WL, we think of it as a Gauss-Markov random field, which is only defined in the points Xi. This W is a Gaussian field defined on the manifold L. So what we prove is that there exists a transport map, which is close to the identity, that maps M to the points Xi, such that if you just interpolate this Gauss-Markov random field into the manifold through this transport map, which you can use to define an interpolation map, then this resulting field, which is now defined on the manifold, is close to the Matern model. So a very, very brief outline of the proof of this. We write, and this is also to solve, to answer more precisely the question as to how to formalize the solution of the SPD. We are working on compact manifolds where the Laplacian can be diagonalized, has a discrete spectrum. And so the SPD definition of the Matern model tells us that the Matern field can be written in terms of the eigenvalues of the Laplace-Beltrami and the eigenfunctions of the Laplace-Beltrami operator as this infinite sum. Similarly, by definition, WL composed with this transport map can be expanded this way. So then what the proof boils down to is using results from spectral analysis of graph Laplacians, showing error bounds with rates for the approximation of the eigenvalues of the graph Laplacian to the eigenvalues of the Laplace-Beltrami operator, and similarly for the eigenfunctions. Okay, so this is kind of a summary of approximation results of graph-based Matern fields to Gaussian fields that satisfy a Matern model on manifolds. Now, let me briefly mention first application of this way of thinking about Matern fields and also an application of the theory. So SSL here denotes semi-supervised learning. So let me just describe briefly what is semi-supervised learning. So in machine learning, there's two traditionally very important tasks, which is unsupervised and supervised learning. Unsupervised learning, you are given inputs and you want to find a structure in your data. For example, you are given a collection of images and what you want is to be able to do, for example, clustering, say that some images look like they belong to a to the same type of images and another group may belong to a different type. A second traditional task is supervised learning, where you are given inputs and outputs, and what you want to do is find an input-output map. For example, you are given images, but you are also given outputs. Outputs here being labels as to whether each image is a cat or a dog. And then what you want in this example is to find this input-output map with a classifier, such that if I give you a new image, you give me a label, so a cat or a dog. Semi-supervised learning, as the name suggests, is something in between, where what you are given is labeled data and unlabeled data. Labeled data is pairs of inputs, outputs, same type of data as you get in supervised learning. But in addition to that, you are also given unlabeled data. So just images, if you want to think in terms of the example. The goal here, at least for the purposes of the talk, will be to learn this regression function, which is the value of the labels at all the input data that you have. So what we want is to, if you want to think about it intuitively, find what is the most likely or the expected label at each of the input data x1 up to xn that we are given. Then there's kind of two settings that our analysis will cover. Regression settings, where the y's are taking values in R, and the classification setting, where the ones you can think of arising from a binary classification problem, where Y takes value either 0 or 1. Okay. So, in order to understand this semi-supervised learning, one needs to have some kind of underlying assumption as to how the marginal distribution of X depends on or is related to the this conditional distribution of Y given X. Because otherwise, there's kind of no hope that the unlabeled data can help in learning this regression function. So there's many different types of assumptions that people have used in order to analyze and understand semi-supervised learning. One of them that is together with another one, which is based on cluster assumption. One of them is a manifold setting, where what you assume is that the inputs are supported on a hidden manifold M. And so what this assumption then is used for is because somehow you would use the unlabeled data X to learn the geometry of the underlying manifold M. And together with a smoothness assumption of the function F naught that you want to learn, that knowledge of M together with the smoothness of the function that you want to learn allows you to come up with suitable regularizations for your learning problem. So I'm going to consider a Bayesian formulation of semi-supervised learning. So as always, Bayesian formulations are defined in terms of a suitable prior and a likelihood function. For the prior, something that is interesting about this Bayesian formulation is that the unlabeled data, so the inputs X, are used, all of them, to define the prior distribution, to define the regularizer for your problem. And the labeled data, so the pairs of Xi's and Yi's, are used only in the likelihood function. For the prior, the way that we are going to define the priors are using, as you can imagine, what I was doing in the first part of the talk, the graph-based Matern fields. Now, this phi represents a link function because that will be the identity in the regression setting, and a link function mapping the real line to the interval 0, 1 in the case of classification. The reason why we need a link function in the classification setting is because obviously this function f lot takes values between 0 and 1 in the classification setting, whereas in the regression setting it can take any arbitrary value in the real line. So the prior is, in the regression setting, just the law of our graph-based Matern field. Otherwise, it's just a transformation of that. The likelihood is just specified in terms of the regression or classification setting, in terms of the model that we have. And again, what we are seeking is to learn this function f at all the points x1 up to xn. So all the input data x1 up to x capital N that we have. Okay, so I want to leave some room for questions. So all of the kind of numerical results are reported in several papers that I will give references for at the end of the talk. But perhaps let me mention that something that we investigated is whether using non-stationary graph-based models can help in the classification performance, and also if learning this hyperparameter S that models the smoothness of the field can help improve the classification accuracy. But more than showing tables, I kind of prefer to spend a bit more time describing some of the theory behind this. So something that we can understand using the bounds that we that I showed on the approximation of Gauss-Markov random fields to the Matern model is the posterior construction contraction for semi-supervised learning. So posterior contraction is a popular kind of concept in Bayesian non-parametrics that tells you the rate at which the posterior mass concentrates around the truth that generates the data. So it has been very well studied in many different contexts, but perhaps not that much in the semi-supervised learning context that I'm considering here. And so part of what we are doing here is propose a specific framework in which to formalize this question as to what is the rate of contraction of the posterior distribution. So this pi n, remember, is the posterior distribution given all the inputs xn and all the labels y. What we are saying here is that this posterior distribution contracts at rate epsilon n if most of the mass of this postulium contracts in a circle neighborhood of around the truth F naught that generates the data. So this is kind of the precise definition of what we mean by posterior contraction at rate epsilon n. And the thing is that in this kind of setting where we make the number of inputs x go to infinity together with the number of labels yl that we have, we are going to be able to show a rate of contraction for this posterior distribution pi L, okay? So this is kind of how the result looks like. Again, it's kind of informally described here. So we need to scale the number of unlabeled data points polynomially with the number of labeled data points that we have. So the number of inputs xi that we have in order to be able to achieve the optimal posterior contraction rate has to grow much faster than the number of labels that we have. Also, under this assumption that this number of points, unlabeled points, grows polynomially with the number of labels, and an assumption on regularity of the function F naught that you want to learn, then what we show is that the posterior contracts at this rate, which again depends on the smoothness of the truth and the dimension of the underlying manifold and the smoothness. This is the prior smoothness, and this is beta is the smoothness of the truth. If the prior smoothness is chosen in the right way, meaning this way, in terms of the truth, we recover the optimal, the max optimal rate, which is L to the minus beta to beta plus L. Okay, so the upshot of this is that by using this graph-based Matern field with all the inputs, so it's constructed with all the inputs, if we choose the smoothness parameter appropriately in terms of the smoothness of the truth, this graph-based semi-supervised learning approach has a posterior that contracts most of its mass around the truth at an optimal rate as one increases the number of labeled and unlabeled data points. Again, there's like a few comments about how the proof goes. In this case, the proof is based on general results for contraction of posterior contraction with non-IID data from Gaussian and Van der Waart, and specifically results for posterior contraction with causal priors that were developed by Van der Waart and Van Santel. The kind of key part of the proof in the semi-supervised learning setting is to use that if you have a sequence of Bayesian problems with an associated posterior distributions such that the priors are sufficiently close together, then the posteriors contract at the same rate. Okay? So you have two sequences of problems defined in terms of the same likelihood and priors that are close together, then the associated posteriors contract at the same rate. And so using the results in the first part of the proof of the talk together with this claim here allows us to show that the posterior contracts at the same rate using the graph Matern fields that if we used a Matern type model, which is known to contract at the optimal rate. Okay, are there any questions? Okay, so then I will just briefly mention a couple of other applications. The first one is that another context in which we have been using and investigating the use of graph-based Matern fields is in the context of Bayesian inverse problems that are constrained by partial differential equations defined on manifolds. Okay, so I'm just going to describe briefly what is the goal of this problem. And this is something that if you want to look in more detail, is reported in a paper with John Harlem and Ruiyi Yang. So the idea here is that we have a partial differential equation. So this is an equation for S, which is defined on a manifold M, which we may not have access to, but we may have only access to some points on the manifold, which are here represented in these plots. So the PDE has as input U, and the solution of the PDE is this function S. That is the forward problem. What we want is to learn this input U by taking data from the solution S. So together with this PDE model, we assume to have access to this vector of data Y so that Y I is the value of the solution to this PDE at a collection of points xi that are sampled from the underlying manifold M. So this is kind of pretty much in the same kind of setting as the semi-supervised learning problem that I showed before. The only thing is that in this case, the problem was actually fully supervised because why? So the labels, which in this context arise from observing the solution of a PDE. In this case, we assume that we have labels at each of the points xi, okay? Other than that, the framework is exactly the same as before. We construct a prior on U using the Gauss-Markov random field WL. And then this expression here defines a likelihood function for U for the distribution of Y given U. Okay. And this is kind of just like a result where this is actually the true parameter U that we wanted to reconstruct. And what you see is that this is the posterior rule. So this is the posterior distribution over U, which is quite close to the truth. And these are plots for the error, meaning the distance between the truth and the mean, and also plots for the standard deviation of this function U that we are trying to learn. Okay, and just finally to close, this kind of graph-based representations of Matern field can also be used in traditional or more traditional spatial statistics applications. And for instance, something that we tried was to use it for this kind of classical problem of interpolating spatial data. The kind of thing that we did here that is slightly in an unusual kind of setting is that what we investigated is interpolating spatial data that is given to us in terms of this kind of discrete locations, and using nothing else than distance between the points where we want to interpolate the data. So specifically, the application that we looked at was interpolating the precipitation data for county level annual precipitation. So there's kind of 3,000 counties in the United States. We have access to the distance between each pair of counties xi and xj. This distance is actually distance measured in terms of the geodesic distance on the Earth. So this kind of like fits well the manifold assumption that we use in order to motivate the definition for the Gauss-Markov random fields. And with these distances, which are used to define the similarity matrix for our graph Laplacian, we consider the problem of interpolating the precipitation data, meaning that we assume that we have access to, let's say, 4% of the data. So we have access to the precipitation for 4% of the counties. And based on that, and how close each pair of counties are, we want to infer what is the annual precipitation data in the other counties that we cannot observe. Okay, and the results that we get from using the graph approach are very similar to the results that one can get from traditional approaches from spatial statistics, which shows that in the context of traditional applications in spatial statistics, or applications where your data, so the xi's, are concentrated in Euclidean domains or manifold settings, the graph approach has a comparable performance to traditional methods. But as illustrated in the semi-supervised learning application, where the xi's may represent images that are kind of very high dimensional, this graph approach can be used in contexts where the ambient space is very high dimensional, but the data is concentrated in a much smaller dimensional manifold. And so just the upshot is that this graph-based representations allow to model Matern-type Gaussian fields, which have been widely studied in the spatial statistics literature. They give you the computational benefit of using the fact that the graph Laplacian is sparse to speed up computation. And they allow you to generalize the Matern model to unstructured point clouds, such as those that may arise in applications such as semi-supervised learning. And the other thing from the top is that using error bounds on the approximation from the graph models to the standard Matern models, among other things, one can understand posterior contraction rates using graph-based prior distributions.
Daniel, is this the end of the talk? Thank you very much for the very interesting talk. Do we have any further questions from the audience? So you can speak directly if you wish.
Yes, may I have a question, please? Can you go back to slide that you mentioned the rate of convergence?
For the products or for the
M W? So here, why do you need a transport map? Because they are different spaces, or
yeah. So W is in this case is a function, a random function, defined on the underlying manifold M.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a function that is defined for any point in your manifold.
I
but
see.
This is a discrete discretely indexed field. So it is only defined in the points xi. So
I see. What a transport map is it like a push forward or property measure or something like that?
Yes, you're right. So the specific setting is that. So what we are analyzing here is the convergence of this WL to this field W,
mm-hmm.
under the assumption that the WL is constructed using a graph Laplacian,
okay.
where the points xi and xj are sampled from a density supported on the underlying manifold M.
I see.
So that density is a density supported on the underlying manifold M. But one can consider the empirical distribution of the points xi.
I see.
So what the transport map represents is a map that maps the points. So in this case, it's a map from M to XL that maps the density with which it's a transform map in the sense that if you push forward the density with which the points are sampled through this map TL, you obtain the empirical distribution on the point cloud XL.
Do we have any further questions?
Yeah. Can I ask a question? Yeah. And so actually I'm just curious, like how this, let's say the kind of the dimensionality of the physical space actually affect this, your method or?
At all. So the angle space dimension plays no role here. Everything that matters is the dimension of the manifold. So like the, if this manifold is embedded, this manifold we assume that is embedded in a Euclidean space RD,
mm-hmm.
that dimension D is irrelevant. All that matters is the dimension of M.
I see. So because you use a graph Laplacian, so it's kind of the physical space really doesn't matter that much, right?
Yeah, you're right, yes.
So which means like in principle, let's see what you are doing here can be used, for example, like a Gaussian process regression.
Yeah, you're right. So like in this, for example, in this kind of context, and this is something that we actually computed. I mean, so it's not, we computed it in a laptop and it's not hard at all. The xi's are in dimension 512, if I remember correctly. So that would be the dimension of the ambient space. But actually, let's say that the intrinsic dimension of this data set is not 500 because there's a few degrees of freedom as to how digits of threes and eights look like. So this is an example where in this context, there's no clear notion of the underlying manifold, but there's a notion that the intrinsic dimension is much smaller than the ambient dimension. So in this context, like the ambient dimension is like 500, but the intrinsic dimension is, I mean, the scale of the literature of what is the intrinsic dimension for this list data set, but is at most like a dozen or something like that. Dozens, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
So can I ask one question? Because I'm particularly interested in this Laplacian graph Laplacian. So the inverse of that metric, right? So do you know, by your knowledge, what's the most efficient algorithm to solve this Laplacian equation? Let's say we have n number of points, and what would be the complexity of?
That is a question that I think it's hard to answer in generality, because it depends on the sparsity of the graph Laplacian.
Let's say we use nearest neighbor to build a graph.
Yes, but the issue here is that, so in order to define the graph Laplacian, one is to define some similarity, which I mean, you can, in this kind of context, we are using this epsilon graphs, or you can use k-nearest neighbors. Mm-hmm. But you need to choose some parameter that eventually is going to determine what is the sparsity of the similarity matrix. And once that you know what is the sparsity of this matrix, this is a diagonal matrix, so that will give you the sparsity of the of this matrix. In general, I mean, if you don't make any assumption on how you define the similarity matrix, all that you can say is that the factorizing this is going to scale like the cubic of the number of points. Because that's like, if you assume that, if you don't make any assumption on this similarity matrix, this would be an arbitrary matrix, and factorizing an arbitrary matrix costs like the cube of the number of points, which is the issue with Gaussian fields. Now, if you make assumptions on the similarity matrix, this can be reduced to a scale like not like the cubic of L, but like L. For example, if you assume that you are in a hidden Markov model, where this graph Laplacian eventually is going to be diagonal. Or not diagonal, but like diagonal, or like it's going to have like some bounded structure. So it all depends on the similarity matrix, right?
Yeah. But do you have, are you normally inverting the metric directly, or you develop some fast algorithm like?
No, we don't invert the matrix. We work with the precision matrix, and then we do a Cholesky factorization, and that's, and I mean, like, if that is sparse, that's kind of like the way to go, I think.
So how big is your problem normally? Like, how many data points?
It depends, so like thousands. So, but I mean, it's just we only do it in our laptop, but, for example, for the precipitation data example I showed, I know that there's like 3,000 counties in the United States. So that's the size of the problem.
Okay, thank you very much.
Do we have any final questions?
Yeah, one quick question. Can I ask?
Okay,
you?
Sure, go ahead.
So in your theoretical result that you showed, the first theorem,
yes.
Oh yeah, this one. This CS constant, it depends on the regularity of the covariance.
Yeah, it depends on the relationship between S and M. I actually didn't write it here because there's different cases that we study like one by one in the paper. So like if I wrote the whole paper, it would be like the whole theorem, it would be quite large.
Uh-huh. So does it depend on nu?
Sorry, what is nu?
Nu is the parameter in the original.
Well, nu and s is the same thing because there's a one-to-one relationship between nu and s. So nu is like s minus d over 2 or something like that.
Oh yes, but that constant, does it have explicit dependence on s? Or it's implicit?
Explicit, but I mean, it's kind of case by case, yeah. So okay. Like it depends case by case on how large S is depending on M.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the talk. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Do we have any other questions?
Yeah, very quick. Is it sure. Related to another question? So you mean because I just want to know what is the relation between S and the parameter in the Matern model?
What is the relationship between what and what?
S at the power S here and yeah, the power S here.
Yeah, so the relationship is, I probably don't remember exactly, but I think it's mu is equal to S minus D over 2, something like that.
Okay, because for this time model, I think, if I remember correctly, it quite depends on if S is bigger or smaller, 1 or 2, then... Okay, so and you mentioned in the general manifold, then you simply substitute the distance here, right?
You mean like to define this similarity?
Yeah, when you mentioned that you can generalize to manifold, then you simply substitute the Euclidean distance by.
To define the similarity, you can use the Euclidean or you can use the manifold distance. It really doesn't matter for the purposes of the analysis because they are the same up to an error term that is irrelevant for the purposes of the analysis. So it's kind of like these results are asymptotic in L, so that eventually we are going to be in a regime where the number of points is very large, and then the distance between points that are close together is the same whether you consider Euclidean distance or manifold distance up to an error term that is negligible for the purposes of the rest of the analysis.
Okay, thank you very much.
And Daniel, can I ask one final quick question?
Yeah, sure.
So the approach, the SPD approach you mentioned here, does that only work for this Matern model or it works for much general, you know,
as long as you have some kind of elliptic type operator, so like I presented it like in a simplified setting, just tau identity minus Laplace Beltrami, but I mean you can change this as long as so this would be like the same but with a more general elliptic type of operator, as long as you have something that is positive definite, or negative, because I mean the sign changes depending on the convention that you use. That's all that matters, right? Because eventually what you want is to define the covariance operator of this field in terms of something that is actually a covariance operator. So it has to be trace class, right? So, and that is also related to the fact that S and M have to be related because otherwise this is actually not, to start with, is not a proper covariance operator. But also later on we need more assumptions on S and M to guarantee, for example, conditions that guarantee that W actually has continuous sample paths or has paths that are in an infinity, right? So that's also like where these conditions on S come from.
Okay, thanks. Do we have any final questions? If not, we've already had quite a lot of questions, so I will end the seminar here today. Thank you very much all for attending the seminar, and thanks very much for Daniel. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for organizing it and for all the questions. It was very enjoyable.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.